Beverly. My name is Maya. I come from the planet Psychon, but currently I am living on Moonbase Alpha under the direction of Commander Koenig. Now, I am one of your siblings in disguise, be it a girl or be it a guy. Well, it's best I reveal myself. Are you ready for me, Beverly? Are you ready for me to reveal myself? Well, here we go.
Oh, hi, Bev. How's it going? It's your brother, Ron. Oh, look, sorry, Bev, I couldn't make it over to your 60th birthday there in Australia. Our bloody Prime Minister, Jacinda, she's gone and closed all the bloody borders so none of us can get over there. And hey, look, I would dearly love to have got over there. I even tried to sweet talk Jacinda. I tried to sweet talk Jacinda and say to her, well, look, you know, I'll pay for all the two jumbo jets. I'll pay for the flight attendants, for all the aviation fuel to get us all over there safely. But you know how it is. She just says to me, well, no, Ron, we are currently in a lockdown. You cannot go to Australia. So I thought, bugger. So we had no Trans-Tasman bubble thing going there. She still hasn't opened it up for us. But anyway, Bev, now look, Jacinda said she's very sorry that, you know, she can't let all the whānau come over to Australia for your birthday. But anyway, Jacinda's got a bit of a message for you, Bev, which I thought was pretty cool. She's a pretty cool chick, you know. She was quite happy to do a bit of a message. So, where are you, Jacinda? 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 I've got to go and find her now.
Hello, Beverly. This is the Prime Minister of New Zealand, Jacinda Ardern. How are you going there, Beverly? Look, I'm really, really sorry that I couldn't let Ron and all the whānau come over for your 60th birthday to celebrate for you in celebration of your life, Beverly. But hey, look, you know how things are with the lockdown. We have to keep things as they are currently, keep the borders closed, and hopefully things will get better and we can open up our Trans-Tasman bubble. But hey, Beverly, I'm sure you're going to have a real awesome shindig, a real awesome hui over there with the whānau that's currently there at the moment. So my utmost apologies I send to you, Beverly, but also I want you to have an awesome birthday, Beverly. Go hard, rock on, girl. And remember three things. Wash your hands. And be kind to one another. During this time of the coronavirus and the COVID-19, it's bloody pissing me off because it's stuffing up our economy. But anyway, never mind, Beverly. You're going to have a great time anyway, for sure. And yeah, so ka kite. Bye.
Cha tu meke. That was so awesome of Jacinda. I mean, Cinderella. Jacinda, sorry. Sorry, Jacinda. Jacinda. That was so awesome of Jacinda to send her birthday wishes, Beverly. What an honour from our Prime Minister of New Zealand. New Zealand. Fashion chaps. Yeah, so Bev, yeah, I reckon you're going to have an awesome time, just like Jacinda said. And I've got a few things I need to say about you, Bev, about fun times growing up with you. And now let me think. Anyway, sis, you've had a really big influence on me growing up. And been quite impactful to me along the way. But my very first memory of you, the very first memory when I was quite young was, I remember we were moving away from the old farmstead, Otangiwai, and we were moving into Napuke to live where Dad bought the new farm. And I remember Dad was trying to round up some of the livestock to put on the back of the trailer, and I think he had a big sheep truck take all the sheep and cows to Napuke, but we had a few of the pets, you know, the animals. I remember we had this pet pig, and I remember Dad and Ivan were trying to tackle the pig, and I remember this vividly. they were trying to tackle the pig, and they were chasing it around the yard so they could put the pig in the back of the cage in the trailer. Anyway, the funny thing was, I remember when they finally caught the pig, and they were, Ivan was trying to hold the pig down, and the pig was going, like, you know how pigs squeal or whatever, oink, oink or whatever, and a bit like Deliverance or something, and squeal like a pig, boy. And but I remember, anyway, I always remember it was so funny, because this is one of the funny things I remember about Beverly. So there was so much going on, the pig squealing and at the top of its lungs. Dad's yelling at Ivan saying, hold the bloody pig down, and Ivan's going, well I am, well I am. And Beverly's laughing and she's going, so I didn't know which was funnier, Beverly laughing, the pig squealing, Ivan going, well I am, well I am. But I think the funniest thing was just seeing Beverly just sitting there, she just couldn't stop laughing, because she was just taking it all in, listening to this pig squealing and Dad yelling at Ivan, and oh God. But yeah, I remember your laugh, Beverly, it was like, yeah. But anyway, what else can I think of about Beverly? What else? Yeah, but no, but Beverly, you've been an awesome sister over the years. You know, you've almost been like a mother figure to me. Because as you know, we all had to grow up quite quick, you know, when Mum died. And I guess I kind of looked at you as kind of like a mother figure. And even though you were still a teenager, you know, growing up at the same time, you know, you were still having to go through puberty, like, and all that sort of thing as well. And yeah, I thank you for being an awesome sister to me. Yeah, but wow. What else can I think of, Beverly? What else can I think of? Actually, Beverly, I do remember you were a bit like a dear Abby to me, because I remember you gave me some really good advice. I remember when we moved into Te Maranui from Otangiwai, I never adjusted that well to Ngāpuke school. And, you know, I remember coming home from school because I was always upset because I was always being called a honky. And it really used to hurt me, because I thought, well, we go home and then we look at our dad, he's Māori looking. And I'd go to school and, you know, because obviously not all of us show Māori features, you know, in our family. Well, not full Māori features. And I remember you knew for some reason I had been upset for most of this particular week. And I remember you sat me down and you said, well, what's wrong? What's been happening at school? And I do remember, Beverly, you said to me, look, you're just as good as the rest of the kids there. Go to school with your head up high, know who you are, and know your dad's Māori. And don't let the kids bother you. Just remember you're just as good as they are. But I do remember the day Dad came to one of our sports days, and some of us are standing next to Dad, some of our dad's kids, and they're kind of looking a bit puzzled. You know, they had to eat humble pie because they realised, well, their dad's Māori looking. And so, and I never really understood the concept of being called a honky, because obviously in our family we're kind of mixed race. So, but yeah, you really set the tone. You made me feel really, really good. And from then on, I do remember not feeling inferior about being who I was. And yeah, so thanks for that, Beverly. You probably don't remember it, but I do. I was probably about 7 or 8, I think, then, or 9 or something. Yeah. So thank you. There's one funny kind of thing I do remember about you as well, Bev. I think, because you and David were having a fight one day, well, like a verbal argument in the lounge. This was in Ngāpuke. And I remember you were fully pregnant, carrying Michaela at the time. And I remember, I think Beverly had just had enough, and she was pretty much almost full term pregnant. And I think you got sick of David always picking on me and Joe, well, mainly me. And I remember Beverly, I don't know, she started arguing, Beverly, you started arguing with David, and then and I remember you saying to David, go on, stress me out, make me have a miscarriage then. Come, you're stressing me out. Do you want me to have a miscarriage? And I remember Beverly, I remember you grabbed a wooden spoon and went up to David's head, and you went pop on David's head with this, as well as a big porridge stirring spoon or something. But I remember Joe and I got quite scared, because we freaked out. We thought there was going to be a big fight between you guys. So we went running out of the lounge. We pushed the sliding door off the hinges. Didn't even slide it. We just went bump. And I do remember a bit like those cartoons, you know, like how Sylvester the Cat or whatever, they go through a wall and then you just see the silhouette. But with us, it was like, boom, push off the... But I do remember you with the wooden spoon. It was such a light tap. You just went up and went, boop, on David's head with this wooden spoon. And me and Joe went cheering out of the lounge and pushed the sliding door off and ran outside because we were freaking out. Yeah, but, yeah. What else, Beverly? Actually, Beverly, your lovely daughter, Jessica, she has asked all of us to think of some kind of scenario where we got a phone call maybe the early hours of the morning that you've been locked up and put in jail. And now let me think now, what would I think you'd be locked up and put in jail for? Here's one. I think probably, this was probably on a Saturday night. Jeff's sort of he's gone to work, he's on a night shift on the railways, and all your kids are, the kids are stressing you out, they're all driving you up the wall, so he decides to go and lock them all in the garage. And all the neighbours can hear all these kids screaming and going, let me out, let me out, let me out, let me out, mum! And anyway, so the police turn up and they decide to lock you up, Beverly, go and take you inside in jail for the night, and the neighbours have to come and look after all the kids because you locked them in the garage. And hey, but that's only a mythical story, that would never happen. But yeah, I couldn't think of anything. You're such a goody two shoes, Beverly. Yeah, what else can I think of, Bev? And now Jess is also asked us to mention something that Beverly can do that we can't do, or Beverly can do that I can't do. I can't have babies. How do you do that, Beverly? How do you have babies? How do you push out a baby? Actually, Beverly, and you know, one of the things that I love about you the most, that really smacks home with me, that it always reminds me of you, is your sense of humour and your infectious laughter. So you've got this signature laugh, I don't know why, just like I mentioned before about the pig squealing, when you're laughing when the pig was squealing. But yeah, you kind of got this laugh which is like, and for some reason you say, oh God, well you say, oh God, like not with a D, you go, oh God. And that's what reminds me of you, Beverly. Like, all of us cribs have got our own signature laugh, like Peter's kind of like, or whatever, but like, Beverly, your laugh is just really takes the cake. Yeah. But yeah, I really love that about you, sis, is your sense of humour and your choice as laughter. Actually, Beverly, I've got a song that comes to mind that always reminds me of you. Actually, I've got a couple of songs. But look, the first one was by one of our New Zealand, she was one of our songbirds from the 1970s. And every time I hear the song on the radio, I don't know why, but she always reminds me of you because she always liked her. And my memory's not always that bad, but I do remember you really love this person. And yeah, have a listen. Oh, how she could ride. So what do you think? So that was Sharon O'Neill. So Sharon O'Neill, she's awesome, still awesome today. And I do remember, Beverly, there was a particular hook in that song that you always liked. It was kind of, wasn't really a hook, but it was, the song would kind of go up a key. And it was kind of like, she'd go, tonight. So she'd kind of make the song, the word tonight, go up a key. And for some reason, you liked the way it slid upwards. I remember that. You have a listen. Can't beat those old school songs, eh, Bev? Hey, but look, what I do really remember, and this artist totally reminds me, I always think of you, Beverly, I don't know why. Now, this is our diva from the 1970s, Donna Summer. Now, to all of you millennials out there, or younger, or whatever, if you don't know Donna Summer, she was the disco queen of the 70s. Okay, you've got Beyonce, she's Queen Bee, you've got all these other ones, but I'll tell you, Donna Summer was like the 1970s answer to Whitney Houston, Beyonce. But yeah, I don't know why, but for some reason, because I remember, Beverly, you used to kind of try and comb your hair like Donna Summer. He had an afro comb and used to kind of tease your hair out. I just remember that for some reason. And then you'd wear like a flower in your hair. And yeah, I don't know. Every time you hear Donna Summer, I think of you, Beverly. But here's a song really reminds me of you, Beverly. Yeah. So take a look at this song. Man, that was some good stuff back then. God, what a powerhouse singer she was, Donna Summer. But you know what, Beverly? I reckon in that video, you're Donna Summer in disguise. And I reckon the guy up in the DJ pit, I reckon that's Jeff. And you know why? Because Jeff was always the muso man. And he always brought music to our lives. When he moved to Taumarunui and started dating you, Beverly, I remember going to your guy's house and Jeff always had the stereo cranked up. This guy come all the way from Auckland to this country bumpkin town and put a bit of life into us, you know. And but I reckon, now you watch again, I reckon it's you and Jeff in disguise. See, I told you it was you, Beverly, you and Jeff, at the discotheque, your humble romantic beginnings where you met up. But actually, Beverly, you and Jeff actually influenced me to actually really fall in love with Donna Summer's music, so much so that you and Jeff actually gifted me this Donna Summer album. This album is on the radio, that's the name of the album. Yeah. Real treasured memories for me, so thank you. I've looked after it all these years, and yeah. Hey, but I do remember Jeff going to your guys' place, and Jeff always was the man, the music man, always had the sounds going cranked up, had his mixtapes playing, so you could always guarantee there'd be, you know, the life of the party going on at your guys' house. And I remember Jeff always had like hungies pits all over the place. He was always doing a hangi, so you can always guarantee a good hangi. Not a hangi pants, a hangi. Yeah, But anyway, Beverly, you know, I'd love to just say, wish you a big, big happy birthday, 60th birthday. You don't look a day over 59 and a half. But yeah, so, you know, sorry we can't all be there, but I'm sure you're going to have an awesome time. And you've done really great, Beverly. You've got awesome, all my nieces and nephews, Your kids are all awesome. They're all really focused. And you and Jeff have done a really great job. And you've got awesome muckles as well. So, yeah. But anyway, you have a good one, Beverly. And I hear Maya's calling. She's telling me she can only remain as me for an hour. So hang on a minute. Hang on, Beverly. So Maya's calling, Beverly, so I've got to go. So you have an awesome time out there, and
Hi, Beverly. Thank you so much for letting Mom entertain you and talk to you. And you have a happy 60th birthday, Beverly. I must go now. I must go back to Moonbase Alpha. Commander Koenig is calling me. Goodbye, Beverly. Ka kite.